I'm Eric Kelly from KellyPlanet.com, and this is a closer look at Star Trek Lower Decks, Season 2, Episode 1, Strange Energies.
Engage.
Hey, we're back for Season 2, and that's a Galler-class cruiser, which means we're dealing with Cardassians. I'm not going to make the Kim joke. Cardassians were mentioned in Season 1, but this is the first time we get to see them in Lower Decks. We all know that's Mariner, but wouldn't it be awesome if it turned out to be Arnold Schwarzenegger? It's a little bit of action movie humor. So Mariner beats the crap out of a bunch of Cardassians, and Boimler says,
"You gotta get me out of here. They keep showing me lights."
"No, I am still mad at you."
Which is a reference to Picard's torture scene at the hands of Gul Madred in the TNG episode Chain of Command. Madred was played by David Warner, who was also in Star Trek 5 and 6.
"If we're going to the Titan, but you knew I wanted to get a promotion. You're supposed to be my mentor."
"You snuck off in the middle of my shift without saying goodbye. You know who my best friend is now? My mom. It sucks. It's like work."
This is to remind us that at the end of Season 1, Boimler got promoted to the USS Titan with Captain Riker, and Mariner is stuck on the Cerritos. I just had to look. Besides being a TOS-era Miranda-class ship, it's from a Mirror Universe comic from the 80s. There's a Jem'Hadar fighter that's definitely some Danube-class runabouts and some Bajoran and old Klingon ships. It's kind of hard to tell. You're just going to have to trust me. I freeze-framed that and saw the Delta Flyer in there. If you haven't guessed, we are on the holodeck, and we haven't even gotten to the opening credits yet.
"So you work out by staging Cardassian prison breaks?"
"Yeah, what do you do?"
Yoga.
"Wow, how unique." "Look, I know we're not supposed to have interpersonal conflict, but I really hate that Andorian."
One of Gene Roddenberry's rules about Trek was there was to be no interpersonal conflict. That kind of limits what you can do story-wise, so you'll notice Deep Space Nine got a lot more conflicted once Roddenberry died. I'm not going to comment about the opening credits because they're the same as last season, except in my Season 1, Episode 1 video for Lower Decks, I pointed out that this scene had 6 Borg cubes and 11 Romulan warbirds, which is an extremely lopsided battle. Now we have 4 Borg cubes, 8 warbirds, 2 pack-led ships, and numerous Klingon birds of prey. For you old-school fans, the title Strange Entities, I meant Strange Energies, should give you an idea of what's going to be going on. The Cerritos has arrived at Apergos for second contact duty. If you remember the last episode, Mariner and Freeman have improved their mother-daughter relationship, and this is starting to bother Ransom as second-in-command. A lot of this stuff is like, hey, remember last season? So Rutherford is suffering memory loss for having his implant ripped out, and he and Tendi are building their relationship back up from scratch. Down on the planet, Mariner accidentally uncovers this monolith that zaps Ransom with strange energies. Like I said, TOS fans know where this is going. This is a direct reference to what happened to Gary Mitchell in Where No Man Has Gone Before.
"Looks like you took a full load of strange energy straight to the cortex."
"What is strange energy, Doctor?"
"Electrical phenomena with unknown properties. It can have all sorts of physical effects. Unlock parts of the brain, even endow godlike powers."
It doesn't take long for Ransom to get into Gary Mitchell mode.
"Now unhand me!"
"And he's hovering. I think he might be going godlike on us."
Excelsior!
Excelsior is a reference to lots of different things in movies and whatnot, but in Star Trek, it's the ship. Tendi thinks Rutherford is suffering from a cyborg brain disease and is trying to cure him. That looks like the gun. It's from a movie. Shot like gel explosives with a timer in the middle. I'll probably think of it tomorrow. Ransom is just floating around doing godlike stuff.
"Damn it!
We have to be a team on this."
"Yeah, no, of course, yeah, love to be a team."
"Stop pretending to like each other. It's making me furious."
Rutherford's on a date with Ensign Barnes, just like in Season 1. And Tendi shoots at him with her medical gun thing.
I think your friend is gonna shoot you."
"What now?"
"Tendi, what are you doing?"
"Sorry to interrupt, but I really don't want you to die again."
See, that's exactly what it's supposed to be. Why can't I... I thought of it. Batman had a gun like that in The Dark Knight. Mike McMahon makes it tough on me. Tendi is determined to cure Rutherford and chases him all over the place. Ransom has turned himself into a giant space head, which reminds me of the big old Scytherian space head guy from the end of the TNG episode, The Nth Degree. But he wasn't angry. His body's still down on the planet, creating a Jack-utopia with gym equipment. Mariner suggests they fire phasers to try to overload him, but that doesn't work. Captain Freeman finds out that Ransom is all mad because of her relationship with Mariner.
Why are you doing this, Jack? Stand down!
I used to be your number one, but then Mariner took it all just because she's your daughter!
Turns out Mariner actually hates being her mom's sidekick, and Freeman hates how Mariner oversteps her bounds all the time.
I hate being your sidekick.
And I hate the way you question me all the time.
You're both fakers! And now you'll pay the ultimate price!
Tandy admits to Rutherford that he doesn't really have a disease. She's been after him all this time because she thinks he'll decide he doesn't like her anymore because of his memory loss. Rutherford forgives her because of their mutual love for science. Captain Freeman tells Ransom she has been wrong to be preferring Mariner over him and realizes she can defeat him with compliments.
You're right. Mariner and I haven't been on it. You're a great officer, Jack. You're a fine commander. You're in phenomenal shape. You're an amazing pilot, a brilliant tactician.
Well, that helped, but the real reason he is weakening is because Mariner has been kicking him in the balls down the planet many times. Dr. Tana smushes him with a boulder because that's what Kirk did to Gary Mitchell. Everything goes back to normal, and somehow Ransom hasn't been crushed to death.
All right, big guy. Today I'll be reading you Nightingale Woman. Thanks, little buddy.
Nightingale Woman is from a poem recited by Gary Mitchell, originally written by Gene Roddenberry. Mariner and Freeman decide to not work together anymore, and Mariner is sent to the brig for insubordination, and she loves the brig. The Cerritos crew is ready for the next week's adventures. But what about Boimler? He's over on the Titan, remember? Well, life is a bit more exciting for him.
Shields at 30%!
Red alert! I'm starting to think this jam session's got too many licks and not enough comp!
What does that even mean?
Yep, that's Jonathan Frakes back as Captain Riker. If you remember, the Titan dropped Deanna Troi off at Talgana 4 in the last episode, so Marina Sirtis didn't have to come back for the beginning of Season 2. If I had to pick on this episode, I guess I'd have to point out again that this borrows heavily from the TOS episode Where No Man Has Gone Before, which they make no attempt to hide. They probably did this because there's a bunch of stuff that needed to be addressed regarding the end of Season 1, and there's only so much screen time. We got a bunch of ship references at the beginning, and even with freeze frame, there was some I'm not entirely sure about. The Batman gun thing really had me racking my brain for a while. I just could not remember where I saw that before. Interesting cameo, the Cardassian interrogator at the beginning was voiced by Missy Pyle. This is her first role in Star Trek, but she was a Thermian named Lalari in Galaxy Quest, which is pretty darn close. Seems to me like Season 2 is off to a good start. This is a closer look at Star Trek Lower Decks Season 2, Episode 2, Kayshan, His Eyes Open. Before we even get started here, the title Kayshan, His Eyes Open means we're going to have Temerians in this episode. Well, actually, it's just one. They were referenced in Season 1 from the TNG episode Darmok, but we haven't seen one yet on Lower Decks.
Engage.
Stardate 58001.2. Those who spend their lives and fortunes gathering scientific rarities from around the galaxy call themselves collectors.
The collectors are a reference to the TNG episode The Most Toys, where Kivas Faggio kidnapped Data. Just from that glimpse, it looks like this is going to be a reference smorgasbord, so I'll tackle that later. The owner of that collectorship has died, and the Cerritos has been asked to help go through his items in case any are dangerous.
Wasn't he the one who tried to collect Data?
They all tried to collect Data.
See, they reference collecting Data, like I said. Since Shax was killed in the first season finale, we have a new head of security, Lieutenant Kayshan, who is Temerian. Told you.
Rapunki, when he joined the Seven.
I'm just going to go out on a limb here, but since Jack Quaid is in this show, Rapunki joining the Seven could be a reference to The Boys.
Sorry. The Universal Translator doesn't always.
If you aren't familiar with Temerians, they natively speak in metaphor, which they make a point of in this show. Oh, look, there's so much stuff. Since Boimler is on the Titan at the moment, we need another character to fill in. So they use Lieutenant Manhaver from the first season. Notice he's not a lieutenant anymore. We'll talk about that later.
Yeah, but the Titan's such a big deal. I bet he's living the dream.
Mr. Boimler, attack pattern Delta. Target the aft shield. Let's see all these pack lets do with their aft hanging out.
Yes, sir.
I noted this in a previous episode. Life on the Titan is way more exciting than the Cerritos, and Boimler may have bitten off more than he can chew.
We're
your away team reporting for duty.
It is a pleasure to meet you, and I look forward to, Darmok and Jalad on the ocean.
That's a direct quote from the TNG episode, Darmok.
Yeah, about time, Starfleet. What you do, stop to debate the human rights of a robot?
That's a reference to the TNG Exocomp episode, Quality of Life. Oh, here we go. I'm going to freeze frame this stuff and try to catch everything. I'm sure I won't. Above the door are mounted weapons on the left. The top one, my brain told me, was used by a Vulcan executioner, but that's wrong, and I can't seem to figure it out, so maybe you can help me. Below that is a Lerpa used by Kirk and Spock for Calafee in the episode Amok Time. To the right, and thank goodness I know some stuff, that's an Ushan Tor used by Archer and Shran in the Enterprise episode United. Then we have a Klingon Batleth and Mekleth, and that's just the beginning. I see a Terran Empire flag on the wall. That hexagonal game to the right, I cannot remember. Help me out with that too, maybe. That's a contemporary to us Mars rover right behind them. That was the game from TNG, and I see what could be Sisko's baseball below that. This is fast. That's Lwaxana's gift box from TNG, which was done by Armin Shimmerman. You know, Quark. I'm going to take a little break until the next collector scene. Switching over to the Titan, Riker figures out that the Pakleds are after Viruvian ore. This seems a bit advanced for the Pakleds, so Starfleet is sending the Titan to Carswell Ford to investigate. Oh no, more collector's stuff. There's a statue of a huge salt vampire from the TOS episode, The Man Trap. That's at least the third reference so far on Lower Decks. A case of wine from Chateau Picard. In the foreground is Kalis the Unforgettable's fornication helmet. He is a Klingon religious icon from TNG. In the background is Odo's bucket from DS9. There's Riker's trombone. That's Data's mask from the TNG episode Masks, and a foil because of Picard and Guinan fencing. I'm not going to bother looking up the other two swords. They set off a security system, and Kayshan gets zapped and turned into a puppet. And the away team moves to another part of the collector's ship, trying to get to the escape pods. There is a portrait of a cat on the wall that is supposed to be Data's cat Spot, though I don't see the resemblance. So, in the Hall of Skeletons, I think that's supposed to be a Gorn. We, of course, have the bones from Spock 2 from the animated series episode The Infinite Vulcan. Gonna guess Mr. Hornhead back there is a Megato.
Uh-oh, I think you triggered some kind of network response.
Oh, what are they gonna do, suck us to death? They're gonna suck us to death!
Space Roombas. There's Abraham Lincoln and an Excalibur, both from the TOS episode The Savage Curtain. Boimler's away team infiltrates the Pakled mining operation.
This ain't your lucky. Huh? It's a pile of snacks.
Hey, those miners are stealing our snacks!
But they get caught and have to get out of there. Faced with impending doom from the Space Roombas, Mariner and Manhaver decide it's time to listen to Tandy and Rutherford, because the nerds know.
As if you say it is, buddy.
Stay alert, stay alive.
Damn!
The Pakleds have the away team cornered, and the Titan can't beam them to safety.
Requesting emergency transport.
Get them out of there!
I can't, sir!
Why the hell not?
Because there's transporter interference, because there always is when there needs to be.
I love that when Riker was on the Enterprise, he was out there jamming on the trombone and catching love disease and acting in plays and meeting his identical transporter clone, Thomas.
That's a reference to the time that Riker got cloned by the transporter in the TNG episode Second Chances, which gives Boimler an idea on how to overcome the transporter distortion field.
Can't believe the captain has a transporter clone.
Yeah, Thomas Riker. He was created from a distortion field that was actually a lot like...
What are you doing?
We might not have to die!
Initiating drill.
Reversing the polarity!
They're always reversing polarity. Boimler gets himself and his team safely to the Titan, but there's a shuttle inbound from the planet, and... it's a transporter clone copy of Boimler, just like what happened to Riker.
Aw, oh, man, a copy of me got transported out?
Boo.
I'm the transporter clone?
Boo.
The distortion field must have... Oh, I've heard this tune before.
Riker decides that one Boimler has to return to the Cerritos as an ensign, while the other stays with him on the Titan. Original Boimler selflessly volunteers, and clone Boimler is like, yeah, I'm down with that.
Nah, I'm good to stay, but thanks, man.
Hey, you like Romulan ale?
Ah, I can learn.
Computer, play Nightbird.
The Nightbird reference is to a jazz piece that's requested by Deanna Troi in TNG, because Riker always missed that one note.
Did you get double promoted? Congrats!
Huh? What do you mean?
You got a whole new pip right there.
Nah, just a piece of corn. That's always happening.
Half the time when you see someone with wrong amount of pips around here, it's usually just delicious street corn.
Okay, so we do this whole pip thing with the corn, which I have been mentioning in previous videos. Manhaver was a lieutenant in the first season, but since the writers needed him to replace Boimler, he had to be an ensign, hence the corn gag. Since this clone thing happened, Boimler gets to be back on the Cerritos.
Oh my god, it's Boimler! It's my friend!
I got transporter cloned.
Ha ha! Pay up!
Damn it!
Are you tired? Because you've been Arnok at the race of Natara through my mind all night. Well, Shaka when the walls fail.
Shaka when the walls fell, another direct TNG quote. If I had a pick on this episode, well, it was fun. Obviously, they had to figure out a way to get Boimler back, and a transporter clone is as good a reason as any. There were so many blink and you'll miss it references, I'm sure I didn't get them all. There were some obvious things that had nothing to do with Trek, like the glaring red sneakers or the vintage arcade machine. I have to admit, after writing this script, I cheated and went through the commentary with Mike McMahon, Jonathan Frakes, and Jack Quaid to see if I can get any more information. Basically, no, they pointed out obvious stuff, but they did mention things I just couldn't find. I can literally jog through this frame by frame if I want to, and I think they were just talking about stuff that never made the final cut. This is a closer look at Star Trek Lower Decks Season 2, Episode 3. We'll always have Tom Paris.
Papusa, hot.
User not recognized.
It's Ensign Boimler, come on.
I had no idea what papusa was, because I'm not cool, so I looked it up. It's a flatbread or griddle cake stuffed with pretty much whatever you want, and it comes from Honduras and El Salvador. Kind of like a Central American version of stromboli, which was invented in Pennsylvania, by the way.
Engage.
We start off in the mess hall with Rutherford and Tendi.
I mean, curing the captain's Torellian death syndrome?
Torellian death syndrome is a reference to Lieutenant Barclay's hypochondria, from the TNG episode Genesis.
Ketchup, spicy kiwi.
Yep, that's Shax, who died at the end of the first season.
Shax is alive?
Yeah, guess so. Bridge officers are always coming back from the dead.
Spock, Kirk, Kelvin Timeline Kirk. Since the title of this is We'll Always Have Tom Paris, you can expect a Robert Duncan McNeil cameo. Dr. Ta'ana is not having a good time. She needs Tendi to go to Quaylor 2, which is from the TNG double episode Unification, and retrieve a family heirloom.
Guess who I get to meet today?
The creator of Fairhaven, Captain Proton himself, Lieutenant Tom Paris!
For those unfamiliar, Tom Paris was a main character for 7 seasons of Voyager. Fairhaven and Captain Proton are holodeck programs he created. Pretty sure he was Lieutenant Junior Grade on that show, and no one got promoted on Voyager, just ask Ensign Kim. But apparently, in this timeline, Voyager is back in the Alpha Quadrant, so you'd think he'd be higher than Lieutenant.
No way! That's awesome! Is he still a salamander?
That's a reference to the Voyager episode Threshold. Shax being back is really bothering Rutherford, and he wants to know how this happened.
Doesn't bug you that he's back from the dead?
Eh, bridge crew always come back.
Fine, but how?
They don't like it when people ask how they came back, man. It's probably just a transporter pattern buffer thing.
Yeah, or a restored Katra, or a mirror universe switcheroo, or the Borg rebuilt him.
Or he could be a future son from an alternate timeline, or maybe he got Genesis device, or a time ribbon.
Or he was trapped in the Nexus.
Nexus, time ribbon, same thing.
So how people come back from the dead, at least on Trek. Scotty came back from the transporter buffer in TNG. Restored Katra was Spock and McCoy. Mirror Universe switcheroo was from Discovery. Not sure what the Borg reference is. I can't think of any characters that came back from the dead that way. A future son from an alternate timeline is from Enterprise with Trip and T'Pol's kid. Genesis device is how they brought Spock back for Star Trek 3. And the time ribbon Nexus thing is how Kirk came back in Generations after dying on the Enterprise B. Tendi stops by and invites Mariner along on her mission for Dr. Ta'ana.
You want to come with?
Wait, me? Not Rutherford?
Yeah, because you know what I realized? You and me have never done a mission together.
This is true. We're 13 episodes in, and it's usually Tendi and Rutherford. The gals arrive at Quaylor 2, and we get a bunch of visual references. Vic Fontaine was a holographic lounge singer in DS9. The Zebulon sisters were mentioned in Season 1 during the choo-choo dance thing. Obviously Quark's from DS9. And I almost missed this, but I know how this show is. That's Emery from the TNG episode Unification, which I mentioned earlier.
How did you see that?
Because I was looking for it.
Is this Gictal? I love that song!
Gictal is super meta. That's from the TNG episode Lower Decks. It was a bullcrap challenge that Worf gave to Seto Jaxa during her training.
Earthcore Paradise! Yeah! I saw them perform that live on Askdim.
Grethor is the Klingon version of Hell. Tendi and Mariner take a peek at Dr. Tana's heirloom and find out that it is a Cation libido post, which Mariner names Jeremy for some reason. Apparently, Cations have to be intimate once a year or they go crazy, kind of like the 7-year Vulcan Ponfar. They get to messing around with this thing and drop it on the floor, breaking off the head.
I've fixed stuff like this before.
You have?
Yeah, no, I accidentally ran over Worf's Mechla back on Deep Space Nine.
What were you doing on Deep Space Nine?
I served there, back before I was on the Keto, you know that.
We find out that Mariner served on DS9 with Worf before her posting to the Keto, which we saw is an Olympic-class ship in Season 1.
I know a fixer on Bonestell who can repair anything.
I swear these shows get more dense as we go. Bonestell is a recreation facility at Starbase Earhart, where Picard got stabbed through the heart by a Nausicaan in the TNG episode Tapestry. Jack stops by engineering to see Billups, and Rutherford is still really bothered by this.
We've got this Tom Paris thing later, but maybe after that, racquetball.
Bashir and O'Brien played racquetball on Deep Space Nine. Mariner and Tendi find their repair guy, and he wants 50 strips of latinum for the job. They don't have that, so Mariner decides to make a wager with some Nausicaans over a game of Donjot, which we first see in TNG. They are accused of cheating, and the Nausicaan smashes the cat post head, and Tendi and Mariner get the heck out of there. I should probably explain what's going on with Boimler. Since he just got back from the Titan, the Cerritos computer doesn't recognize his ID yet, and the doors won't open for him. So he's trying to get to the bridge via the Jefferies tubes to get Tom Paris to sign his commemorative Voyager collector's plate. And here's our Robert Duncan McNeil cameo as Lieutenant Tom Paris.
It's a pleasure to have you on my bridge, Lieutenant Paris.
Pleasure's all mine, Captain Freeman. Mind if I give her a whirl? I hear these Cali-class engines can purr.
All right.
Dr. Tana checks in with Mariner and Tendi, and they have to figure out how to fix the cat post thing, and Tendi has an idea.
There's still a lot of stigma around Orions. A lot of humans, they grow all thieves and pirates. Wait. My cousin works in a thieves' den and a pirate outpost in this sector. He might be able to help us out.
Since Mariner will obviously stand out on an Orion planet, Tendi gives her a disguise. Rutherford is trying to get Shax out of his mind when he hallucinates some Shax spirits. The first one is dressed like Mirror Kirk from TOS. Then we get Borg Shax, Dyson Sphere Shax. Gonna have to freeze frame this. That's Moriarty Shax from TNG. Neelix Shax from Voyager. That's Shax in an Enterprise-style uniform. I might have missed one.
When I'm talking the Nexus, it's always Christmas!
It's always Christmas in the Nexus is from Picard's experience in Generations. Here we are at the Orion Pirate Outpost.
Well, what if I don't sound like an Orion, though?
Just talk like a pirate.
Arr, how you be doing today, me fellow Orion?
Why are you talking like that?
Allergies.
Oh, I hear you. They're really bad this time of year.
Talk like a pirate. So that's Donnie, Tendi's cousin, who's going to help them fix Dr. Tana's cat post thing. But Mariner's disguise wears off early, and they've got to get out of there. Checking on Boimler, he's still crawling through the Jefferies tubes and getting quite dirty. And then he hallucinates... Well, watch.
Come on, Brad! This is your home! You're right where you belong! Now open up a panel and start figuring out a solution!
You're right! Thanks, Tom Paris!
Tom Paris gives Boimler the confidence to keep going.
I am a little worried about the fumes in here, though. You know, since you're talking to a plate.
Even though she will get in trouble with Dr. Tana, Tendi sacrifices the cat post in order to save Mariner, and they head back to the Cerritos. Rutherford corners Shax in the turbo lift and flat out asks him how he came back from the dead. Shax tells him he will reveal the secrets of death, but he'll never be the same again. Rutherford's cool with this. There is an explanation, and it has to do with a black mountain where you fight your father and he makes you eat your heart. I think the writers are just messing with us. By this point, Boimler is looking kind of rough.
I'm gonna die, and it's all because of this stupid plate!
Don't do it, Bradward! Not the plate!
Oh, no!
He finally made it to the bridge.
Tom Paris!
Okay, he's on!
Tom, get it out! Oh!
That was awesome. Tom Paris thought he was a Kazon, which were the original antagonists on Voyager, but they worked out about as well as the Ferengi did in early TNG. Oh, that guy was in that terrible He-Man movie. He was the Blade character.
This is how we kick ass in the Delta Quadrant!
Tendi apologizes to Dr. Tana for breaking her cat pose, but it turns out she just wanted the box, like a real cat.
This one, it's my favorite. It's all about the caves of Nemat.
We're at the end of the episode, and they're still throwing references. The caves of Nemat is where Worf was meditating and conjured up Kalis, in the TNG episode Rightful Heir.
You get your bowl signed by Chakotay or whatever?
Tom Paris, and...
That would be Commander Chakotay from Voyager. If I had a pick on this episode, I guess it would be the whole Shax thing. I mean, I see what they're doing. They killed him off at the end of the first season for dramatic effect, probably with every intention of bringing him back. As I mentioned earlier, this has happened several times in Trek. They brought in Lieutenant Keyshawn to replace Shax, but he only lasted one episode, and then Shax just shows up. I guess I was just looking for an explanation that wasn't Khan's superblood, which was dumb, or the Black Mountain thing. There's a lot of great stuff in this one. We got some more cultural information about the Orions, which I always enjoy. Mariner and Tendi teamed up for once, and that was new. We got to see Tom Paris for the first time in forever. And we get a bunch of references from Tapestry, which was an excellent TNG Q episode. This is a closer look at Star Trek Lower Decks, Season 2, Episode 4, Mugato Gamato. Before we get into this, the running gag here is that when we first see Mugato in the TOS episode A Private Little War, the actors pronounce that name all kinds of different ways. This was not done on purpose. So they do that here on Lower Decks. In fact, they say Mugato in some variation 25 times. And I bothered to make you a montage.
So I was reading up on the Mugatos. Did you know they have alternative pronunciations? Mugatu, Mugutu, and Gumato? Isn't that neat and inconsistent?
Of a Mugato.
See a Mugato.
Poisoned by a Mugato.
These Mugutu, the Gumato life signs. Mugato dumb.
This is just one random Mugato. We're fine.
Mugato stampede!
Books on Mugatos.
Beautiful Mugatos. 5 books on Mugatos.
Mugato trap.
Buy a Mugato.
Live Mugatos.
The Mugato, while the Mugato preserve.
Mukutu Venom Kinden Mugato.
Or the Mugatos.
Those are the Mugato twins. A dozen Mugatos round up their Mugato horn.
The Hokobato.
Engage.
Our pre-title sequence has a nice TNG reference to the sport of Anbo Jitsu from the episode The Icarus Factor, when Riker and his father do some healthy sparring. Boimler and Rutherford are pretty confident in their skills, but of course, Mariner beats the living daylights out of them.
Yeah, I mean...
I'm great. I can finally get in a real workout.
We start off with some Denobulans on a science mission. This is the first time we see this species since Phlox on Enterprise. They are attacked by a Mugato and do that defensive puff-up thing that Phlox did in the Enterprise episode Home when they were back on Earth. So this planet's called Phrylon 4, and the Cerritos is there to investigate the Mugato incident. Starfleet probably thinks this is kind of weird, because Mugato are native to the planet Nerol. That Brack kind of looking dude is Xinti from the animated series. We probably have a Worf situation here, as they are not members of the Federation, but we have one here in Starfleet. Rutherford and Boimler are playing this game called Diplomath, which comes in handy later. Honus the bartender spills some tea about Mariner, and how she might be a Section 31 assassin, which makes sense to the guys, seeing how she recently beat them up.
As if Starfleet would ever hide a black ops agent on one of their own ships.
Yeah, I mean, Starfleet Intelligence does it, and Tuvok did it when he infiltrated the Maquis, and there were a ton during the Dominion War.
Yep, all true.
I need 30 cc's of desalinated Paviatic fluid.
That's not a thing. Tendi is in sickbay with Dr. Tana, who gives her a list of crew members that have yet to have their physicals. So Tendi has something to do for the rest of the show. Rutherford looks up Mariner's record, which seems suspicious.
You don't think she had anything to do with it?
Who to do with what? What's got you so jumpy?
Just excited to see a Mugato.
Oh, you would be. Just stay out of my way down there. Or else.
The away team beams down to see what they can find out about these Mugatos.
Here. Mugato dumb. Fresh. Tangy.
That's just wrong. They discover that the Ferengi are up to no good, and that they have been harvesting Mugatos for profit, because that's, you know, how the Ferengi are. If you notice, these Ferengi look like how we first saw them in the TNG episode The Last Outpost, with the laser whip things and whatnot. Shax informs everyone present that this is against Federation conservation laws, which doesn't go over well, and the Mugato are let out of their cages. In all the chaos, Boimler and Rutherford witness Mariner stab Shax in the chest and drink his blood. We'll talk about that later. So not only are the rampaging Mugatos a danger, but the guys are convinced Mariner is going to kill them. While looking for a hiding spot, they run into Patingi, who is a Tellarite with a crocodile hunter type accent. He's Australian.
Who are you?
I'm Patingi. I've been studying these beautiful Mugatos for years.
Who's been in the field studying Mugatos like Diane Fossey. and he promises to get the boys to safety. Back on the Cerritos, Tendi is going about her busy work, and I'd blow by this, but...
Hi, Lieutenant. Sorry to bother you.
She refers to him as Lieutenant, when in fact he is a Lieutenant Commander, which is a commander. Patingi doesn't last long. Then Boimler and Rutherford run off into the jungle.
Thank you for the DNA scan, Lieutenant.
She calls him Lieutenant again. He's a commander. Tendi gets all the crew on her list, but there's only one left, simply designated as patient 08.019. Who could this be? Tendi's on the case.
Wait. Watch it. Mugato trap.
Mariner catches up with Rutherford and Boimler, and they try to run, but she gets caught in a Mugato trap. They accuse her of wanting to eat them, just like she did to Shax. She explains.
Shax was stung by a Mugato!
Yeah, and you stabbed him and licked his blood. They really messed you up good in that lab.
I had to suck the venom out. What lab?
We know what you really are.
And goes on to tell them she made up the whole Black Ops rumor herself, so people would think she's cool. It's now up to them to save the day, as Mariner gets apprehended by the Ferengi. Tendi realizes that the mystery crewman is Dr. Tana, who's been avoiding getting her physical. She's going to finish the job and chases Tana all over the ship. Tendi breaks her arm, but manages to scan Dr. Tana before she passes out from shock.
You know you guys can just replicate stuff, right? Like the stuff you buy with Latinum, you can just replicate. You guys are dumb.
Mariner points out one of the big issues of how Star Trek portrays life in the future. Pretty much everybody has the technology to replicate anything they want, especially commodities. So capitalists like the Ferengi would have a hard time finding a market.
You guys are what, some creepy throwback Last Outpost-style Ferengi? You ever heard of Quark?
Of course I've heard of Quark!
And she mentions the Last Outpost thing I talked about earlier. I almost missed this. That rocket launcher thing, which we find out is a projector in a few seconds, looks exactly like the makeshift weapon Kirk constructed when he fought the Gorn in the TOS episode The Arena. Boimler and Rutherford give the Ferengi a presentation on the cost-benefit analysis of using live Mugato versus dead ones.
By ending the sale or slaughter of the Mugato while putting an investment in the conversion of this place into more of a Mugato preserve.
Oh no, what's happening?
Those two beautiful nerdy men are negotiating us to safety using the power of math.
The Ferengi are convinced that live Mugato would bring larger profit margins and decide to convert their operation to a Mugato preserve.
From now on, we work for the Mugatos. This place has to be a horned heaven.
If I had a pick on this episode, the one thing I noticed is Mariner's explanation that Shax got stung by a Mugato and that she had to suck the venom out to save him, which makes sense. But we literally see her stab him in the chest, so why would she do that? Of course, the reason is so that Boimler and Rutherford are afraid of her. I was hoping we'd get some kind of cameo with the Ferengi voice work. Tom Kenny was the lead Ferengi Kink. Yeah, his name's Kink. But SpongeBob does all kinds of voices on this show. This episode is another great example of Lower Decks taking an obscure Trek character and doing much more with them. We've only seen Mugato once before in canon. And the whole multiple pronunciation is a real thing from the 60s show, and they had a lot of fun with it here. This is a closer look at Star Trek Lower Decks, Season 2, Episode 5, An Embarrassment of Duplers.
Engage.
The Cerritos is escorting a Dupler emissary to Starbase 25 for trade negotiations. This is the first time we see a Dupler in canon. They have this ability to self-replicate if they feel like embarrassed or scared. It's a defense thing.
Emissary, the last few days with you have been very careful.
Your hospitality is appreciated, Captain, as are your efforts to prevent me from duplicating.
You might recognize that voice. It's not from Trek, and we'll talk about this later. Although being on Dupler duty is kind of a pain in the ass, it's a means to an end. For the senior staff wants to attend the epic Starfleet party on Starbase 25. Mariner and Boimler are stacking crates in a cargo bay, talking about the super cool party and how they can't go because they are just Lower Decks on a support ship. But then Mariner remembers Boimler's transporter clone is an officer on the Titan.
Wait, shut up. The Titan's on the other side of the system deterring the packlets.
So?
So, there's no way they can make it here in time. William's invite is just sitting there. You can pose as your clone and I can be your plus one.
Tendi and Rutherford are working on their model of the Cerritos. The whole reason for this is because they need a plot device later.
What does that mean?
I don't know. But if I did it once, I could do it again. Oh, sorry.
So the Cerritos arrives at Starbase 25. Hold up. This must be like a baby Starbase, because we've seen the Enterprise-D fly into one of these things like a parking garage. Here the ships are huge, relatively speaking. We have two Kamari-style Andorian battlecruisers, two Parliament-class starships, two Olympia-class starships. I don't know what that is, so let's get back to it. Oh, and that ship wasn't there in the previous shot. Freeman is speaking her mind about Dupler, not realizing he has just walked into the bridge behind her.
Was I too much trouble?
No.
He thinks he's been a bad guest and starts duplicating. Then again, and again. If you know how exponents work, you can see how this is going to be a problem. Freeman is told the Cerritos will not be allowed to dock until the Dupler problem is handled. See, that ship is gone again because we need a spot for the Cerritos later. Now we're on the promenade of the Starbase, let's see what we can see. Well, there's Quarks from Deep Space Nine. I guess he's franchised now because we saw Quarks on Quaalar 2 in a previous episode. That Tellarite is bad news, he's from Mariner's Shady Past. Okay, freeze frame the shop. Looks like those could be tribbles up there. It's definitely a 3D chessboard, we see it all the time in Trek. That's the tunic Riker wore on Angel 1. There's a Vulcan Lerpa, and that dude is a Mazarian. First and only seen in the TNG episode Allegiance. His name is Malvis.
I should disintegrate you for stranding me on Seti Alpha 4, which I'll have you know is much worse than Seti Alpha 5.
Okay, that's a Wrath of Khan thing. Kirk thought he stranded Khan on Seti Alpha 5, which is a habitable Class M planet. But instead, it was crappy old Seti Alpha 6, which is why Khan was so full of wrath. So we gather from this that Seti Alpha 4 isn't much better. Malvis tells Mariner that he'll forgive her, and tell her the secret location of the super cool Starfleet party if she moves some merch for him, which turned out to be
limited edition Commander Data bubble bath.
You sure this isn't a lore?
A couple might be lores.
Data's awesome. Rutherford and Tendi are still working on that model, and the Dupler situation isn't getting any better. Boimler and Mariner get pulled over by station security, and it turns out Malvis has illegal Klingon disruptors hidden in the Data bubble bath, so Mariner takes off, and we have a grand chase. We crash through, I assume, Quarks, where some Klingons are playing Dabo. Then a Bolian barbershop, a nod to Mott from TNG. A fine clothing store, a nod to Garrick from DS9. There's a Lurian, like Morn from DS9. A dude in a Captain Pike chair from TOS. There's a bunch of Antedians from TNG. One was originally played by Mick Fleetwood. A Vulcan ship.
Vulcans!
Fascinating.
Tendi and Rutherford are stuck in the repair bay with a bunch of Duplers. They can escape through a hatch in the ceiling, but it has been fused shut. Of course. Those are Aurelians, like Alec Ohm from the animated series. Mariner threatens Malvis that she'll rat out on him, so he gives her the location of the Starfleet party.
Ballroom Alpha? That's where all the big parties are. How is that even a secret?
Here at the Starfleet party, we notice the staff are Nasat, like EM3 Green from the animated series. Boimler is allowed in, but the bouncer recognizes Mariner from the Cerritos and makes her leave.
Whoa, Captain Shelby and her number one!
Captain Shelby is from The Best of Both Worlds on TNG, played by Elizabeth Dennehy. Maybe this party isn't fun without Mariner. Time is running out, but Rutherford has a plan. He and Tendi detonate the warp core on their model and open the hatch so they can escape. Since she couldn't get into the party, Mariner is at a dive bar. Looks like we're going to have a lot of things to look at. I'll do my best. That's probably the USS Voyager, an Intrepid-class ship at least. That's Abaddon from Voyager, played by John Fleck, who is also a Suliban, Romulan, and Cardassian. That's the Guardian of Forever from TOS, not Discovery. These are hard to see, and they look like old references. That's probably Ruck from TOS, played by Ted Cassidy, who is also Lurch and is from Pennsylvania. That's Arix and Mares from the animated series. Looks like the TOS original Enterprise. Lokai from TOS. I thought it was Frank Gorshin at first, who was also the Riddler and also from Pennsylvania. That's Baylock's puppet and the Thalosians. The big one in the back is the Bajoran lightship from DS9. That's a cigarette machine, which we don't even have anymore. Of course, we saw an old school jukebox in the corner, so that fits. And I give up for now. The Cerritos is about to be completely overrun with Duplers, and Captain Freeman's had enough.
Stop being such whiny little...
What did you say?
You idiots need to shut up and stop being sniveling babies!
Did you see that?
They discover that insulting the Duplers will get them to recombine.
Hey,
You're a jerk!
Excuse me?
Your paw is weak, and it disgusts me!
I don't even know what that is, but I don't like your toe!
You wouldn't know a recon converter from a two-lock shifter!
How dare you! I am a guest! I've never been treated like this in my entire life! And now, I am going to my quarters!
Recognize that voice yet? With the Dupler problem under control, the senior staff figures they can still make the party. Oh, we're back at the bar. Let's see if I can catch anything else. There's two starships on the wall, probably the Enterprise. Turns out Kirk and Spock used to drink in here. That's that from Cochrane's ship, the Phoenix, from First Contact. That's the Doomsday Machine from that TOS episode. There's more, but I don't know. I did enough. Freeman and company find out they aren't cool enough to get into the party.
Kudos, you are getting in.
O'Connor is in there?
He's a DJ.
What? He's not even Starfleet!
O'Connor is Thaddean O'Connor from TNG's The Outrageous O'Connor. Manner invites the senior officers to the Kirk and Spock dive bar. Dupler apologizes to Freeman, and she sends him to the Starfleet party.
So sorry!
Myself.
Well, since you're a new Rutherford, I figured it was time for a new model.
Okay, wow. Deep Space Nine came out when I was 12, and I built that model. And I think they were made by Ertl back then. I also did the Enterprise A and D, a Klingon battlecruiser. Those were the days.
Ooh, it comes with Ezri and a Jadzia.
Ezri replaced Jadzia as the Dax character in the 7th season of DS9.
One was my number one. Now he has to grow a beard.
Or a reference to Riker. Aw. If I had a pick on this episode, it would have to be the lame Tendi and Rutherford B story that seems to happen quite often. Though it did result in the DS9 model kit, which I haven't thought about in 30 years. Also, why would you make a model with an active warp core with antimatter and all that kind of stuff? Seems a little dangerous. Between the chase sequence and the bar, there were a ton of references, and I caught as many as I could. And Dupler, as I mentioned, his voice may sound familiar, and that's because it was Richard Kind. He has never been on Trek before, but he was in the original Stargate movie from 94, and he was in two episodes, pretty sure I know that stuff pretty well too, of Stargate Atlantis. This is a closer look at Star Trek Lower Decks Season 2, Episode 6, The Spy Humongous. Before we even get into the story, and maybe I should have noticed this earlier, but we know the Pakleds borrow technology from more advanced species, and their ships are using straight-up Romulan to Derridix-class warp nacelles. There's a story, and I'm pretty sure it's from TOS. I meant TNG. It might be Voyager, I can't remember. Where they use one of those nacelles from an off-the-shelf model as a scanner prop. Now that I look, their ships have the wing gun design that the Klingon Birds of Prey use. Anyway.
Engage.
We open up with the Cerritos at Pakled Planet to negotiate a diplomatic ceasefire, which is something the Enterprise or other capital ship should be doing. Okay. They mention this in the show with the reasoning that Captain Freeman has experience with Pakleds from the Kala System battle at the end of Season 1. But the Enterprise had the Samaritan snare.
Welcome, Captain Janeway.
He calls her Captain Janeway.
Guys, the prisoner Rumdar, he ran away from Pakled Planet to her ship.
You might recognize that voice.
Ransom, is there a Pakled on my ship?
That's an affirmative, Captain.
This is one of the few opening sequences that has something to do with the rest of the episode.
Until she gives Rumdar back, Janeway stays here.
The Lower Decks crew is assigned anomaly consolidation duty, which ends up being just cleaning up after the senior staff. Everyone is bummed except Tendi.
Oh, sweet, sweet Tendi, no. ACD is the most degrading day of the year.
Tendi is amused by Boimler's physical comedy, which is a thing later. Boimler befriends the Red Shirt Club, which is a bunch of junior officers that help each other rank up. We have Jen, the Andorian, the Xinti guy, his name is Taylor, and Ensigns Castro and Casey. They offer to help Boimler improve his image in return for his connections with Riker.
You tell us Riker stuff today, I'll get you in the running for the big chair.
Let's do this.
Excelsior.
There's Excelsior again. I know this is an artistic reference, but there is that ship. Ransom and Kayshan begin to suspect that Rumdar has ulterior motives for being on the Cerritos.
You want to see our top secret defensive schematics?
Yeah,
And your Crimson Force Field, too!
The Crimson Force Field thing was a tactical gambit by Riker and LaForge in The Samaritan Snare from TNG.
Captain Freeman, our Packlet refugee appears to be more of a Packlet spy.
Ransom and Kayshan take Rumdar on a decidedly not high-security tour of the ship.
We're not exactly dealing with the Tal Shiar here.
The Tal Shiar is the Romulan version of Section 31, originally from The Next Generation. The episode where Troy is a Tal Shiar spy. Oh my god, I feel like she said those words like 100 times during an episode, just to hammer home it's a new thing.
Her Majesty the Queen!
The Rumdar is in the bathroom, but he said that you should negotiate a ceasefire.
Oh, I don't have a big enough helmet to do that.
Are you shitting me?
Freeman tries to negotiate with the Queen Packlet, but just like the first guy, she doesn't have a big enough helmet. Which totally reminds me of Spaceballs, now that I think of it.
Boimler, you need to look like a leader if you want people to treat you like one.
First, you've got to fix this posture. You're like this when you need to be like this.
That's kind of funny, because that species was bent over like that in the animated series. So the red shirts give Boimler a makeover with a padded uniform and a new hairdo, which seems like a reference to Anson Mount's hair as Captain Pike in Strange New Worlds.
It'll mess you up!
Damn it, the nanobots! Billups can calculate warp variants, but he can't remember to tighten a lid on a jar.
This happened to Wesley Crusher in the TNG episode Nanite. Hey, look, that's the bridge of the Enterprise D. Mariner, Tendi, and Rutherford are still cleaning up after the senior staff. They could have done so much with this as far as references go, and they certainly have in the past. But yeah, not so much this episode for some reason. Well, except there's no Eye of Thundera on there, but that's definitely Lion-O's sword from Thundercats. Or maybe not. I think my 80s brain is failing me. I looked it up, and before it becomes the Sword of Omens, the cross guard is actually not extended, and the blade's not actually broken. Although that's what sticks in my head, so there's got to be a sword somewhere that looks like that. I just can't remember what it is, and it's not the one from Dark Souls. And that looks like an earpiece Uhura used in TOS. Back on Packled Planet, Freeman and Shax are waiting to negotiate with someone higher up with a bigger helmet. And there's King Packled, and his helmet is huge. Oh wait, there's Emperor Packled, and his helmet is huger. Then all of a sudden, some rebel Packleds crash the party, kill the Emperor, and claim leadership for themselves.
I am now Packled leader! Behold my giant helmet!
He is strong!
There's that voice again. Teddy finally realizes that trash duty sucks, and then this magical cube turns her into a giant scorpion. I have no idea where this is coming from. And she starts wreaking havoc all over the ship because she's pissed about being lower decks. During the mayhem, the red shirts try to help, but all they know how to do is posture.
Never sailed at all.
Are any of you actually going to do something?
We're doing it. We're inspiring the crew.
We are the crew.
So Boimler steps up and gets to work. To placate the irate scorpion Teddy, Boimler dumps food on himself, lights himself on fire. You know, things that you do with, like, two-year-olds.
Computer, tabby, honey, shrimp, soda, corn, sick, chicken, nugget, crispy lemon, rock, candy, chili, gravy, chocolate, sundae, ha!
That reminds me of the way Cartman defeated Saddam Hussein in the South Park movie. I'd play the clip, but it's quite vulgar. Boimler's antics worked, and Teddy is back to normal. Oh, this is pretty funny. They lost Rumdar, but find him in space floating outside the ship. Turns out he went to use the bathroom, but it was an airlock instead.
How did you get outside in the first place?
I went to the bathroom. When I pressed the flush button, I got shot out of a little hatch.
Things are getting hairy on Packled Planet, but then Rumdar returns.
Ah, Rumdar returns. Hi, everybody. We tricked you, Janeway. Rumdar was a spy! Ha 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 ha! What did you learn, spy? The Enterprise has the biggest bathrooms ever. And she is not Captain Janeway. She is Captain Freeman!
That's what I've been telling you.
The moral of the story is Teddy learned to be cool with being lower decks. Boimler learned to be cool with being lower decks. Mariner didn't do much, and neither did Rutherford.
Quick thinking in the mess today, Mr. Boimler.
You showed some real leadership.
Thank you, sir.
Hey, do you want to catch a Winger Bingston show sometime?
You ever see his one-man show where he played all of Jupiter's moons?
That's yet another reference to Winger Bingston, who was voiced by Eugene Cordero, just like Rutherford. As of now, Jupiter has 95 moons, so, wow.
Just got off the comms with Starfleet. Sounds like we did a great job.
The whole negotiate with the Packleds thing wraps up, but nothing actually happens. I guess we are to assume that Freeman did all this off-screen.
Oh, no way. This is a submanifold casting stone.
A what?
We can use it to broadcast our voices to other planets.
Okay, the communicator stone things are similar to, I think, the last season of Stargate SG-1. Daniel Jackson and Vala use them, but in their case, they actually switched bodies with those on the other end.
What's that good for?
Yeah, like, what are we gonna do? Prank call Armus?
Lower Decks loves referencing Armus from Skin of Evil, and this is kind of funny, so I'll just let it play out.
Hey, Armus! You look like a big bag of crap.
Who said that? Show yourself. I am Armus.
Yeah, we already know you're Armus, dummy.
Come and find us.
I am a Skin of Evil.
More like a puddle of
Yeah, that's it. If I had a pick on this episode, well, this is in the running for the least amount of references in an episode, and they had so many opportunities. I love what Lower Decks has done with the Packleds, but the whole negotiation thing went nowhere. Tendi turned into a scorpion, and I have no idea why. Maybe that's a huge thing I missed. I don't know. It was silly. And I love Armus, but it feels like that was tacked on the end for a runtime. The familiar voice I mentioned was Brian Pashane in his first Star Trek role. I've seen him credited as the Queen Packled also, but if that's his voice, well, good job, bro. Maybe there's some modulation going on or something. Does not sound like him. This is a closer look at Star Trek Lower Decks, Season 2, Episode 7, Where Pleasant Fountains Lie. I was going to point this out in the last episode, but I will now since they keep doing it. These last few titles were meta-references. Where Pleasant Fountains Lie is from Shakespeare. The Spy Among Us is a song. An Embarrassment of Riches is a book. And We'll Always Have Paris is from Casablanca, etc., etc. And that is from The King and I.
No!
Engage.
The crew of the Cerritos is helping out these Hellboy-looking guys after their 100 years war perpetrated by the evil supercomputer, Agamas.
It's so embarrassing.
A lot of civilizations blame it on the supernatural. At least you didn't fall for that.
Yeah, that would have been crazy.
Religion.
Hey now, this has all been a huge mistake. Just let me access your computer mainframe and I'll explain everything.
That's Agamas, and as far as I can tell, that's not an acronym or anything. And it's no big secret, that's the voice of the awesome Jeffrey Combs, who's been many characters in Star Trek. Wayuns 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. Brunt, Tyrann, Kevin Mulcahy, all from Deep Space Nine. Penk from Voyager, and Shran and Krem from Enterprise. The Cerritos gets hailed by Queen Palana of Hesperia, who turns out to be Chief Engineer Billup's mom.
And we're being hailed.
On screen. Queen Palana, to what do we owe this pleasure again?
We're having a spot of engine trouble here on the Monaveen. My royal engineers can't seem to suss up the hiccup.
If anybody cares, Monaveen is a luxury fashion brand from London.
Captain, we have completed
the... Oh, my dear Aunt Berithio!
Have you been eating or wasting away? And what happened to that mustache?
It is feeding
on you, taking your vitamins, you mumps.
Andy is short for Aunt Berithio.
Boimy's got a phaser rifle. Nice. Now, how are those different from regular phasers?
They take two hands.
Mariner points out something that's been brought up over the years. Why have phaser rifles? Just because they look cool? Anyone who's actually shot anything will tell you that it's a lot easier to aim a rifle than, say, a hand phaser. Not to mention the larger size would allow for higher capacities and output. So that's why.
Ensign Boimler, report for reassignment to escort of cargo to the Daystrom Institute, but that's what you're doing.
Boimler and Mariner are assigned to escort Agamas to the Daystrom Institute on Earth, which is named after Richard Daystrom from TOS. So it turns out that old Billups is next in line to the throne of Hesperia.
Hesperia. Oh, that's the planet with the dragons that got colonized by all those Renfair types. Did you grow up in a castle?
Yes, but a life of mythical adventure can't compare to working on the old impulse engine.
Rutherford kind of talks like Hesperia is a thing, and it didn't exist before this show. And I don't know why Billup says impulse engine and then points to the warp core, because they are not the same.
The only lady I love is two decks tall and pumped full of dilithium.
Okay, writers have been making this mistake since the original series and probably in every series since, so I'm going to give a quick rundown on how these warp cores work. The energy is derived from the combination of matter and antimatter, namely deuterium, which is a real thing. It's an isotope of hydrogen. That's the fuel. The reaction is controlled with dilithium crystals, which are not a real thing. They are like the carbon rods in a nuclear reactor, you know, sort of. The point is that dilithium is not the fuel and never was. The whole reason the Queen is here is to get Billups to become king, using the excuse of getting him to fix her ship's engines. So Rutherford's job is to help Billups with the engines, And Tendi, well, we don't know what Tendi's doing yet. Mariner and Boimler's shuttle is hit with gravimetric shear and crashes on some planet. It's never named, but it looks a lot like the one that Picard and Wesley Crusher crashed on in TNG.
Mariner! Mariner!
I'm okay. It's just a fracture.
Oh, crap. It's the evil computer. We're not supposed to interact with it.
Hey, hey! Before you close that, consider...
Dang it.
I can contact help! Oh, come on, friends! Help me help you!
Agamus offers to help get them rescued, but he is evil, so that probably won't work out so well.
Good thing the replicator's still intact. Computer, iced tea, splash of lemonade, cold.
Black licorice, dry.
Great, the least nutritious food that tastes the most like poison.
The replicator is broken and only makes black licorice, which is gross.
Come up.
Wait, why bring him with? We could just, bury him, like Data's head.
Okay, actually, Data's head was in a cave, and it's our duty to respect sentient life.
Data's head was found in a cave in the TNG episode Time's Arrow. She probably meant B4's head, which was buried by Romulans, and then later found by Picard, Data, and Worf in Nemesis. An alien bear monster thing attacks and eats all the food, so Boimler and Mariner have to pack up and go out and look for more. And water. Mariner and Boimler find some alien fruit, but it tastes like black licorice too.
It tastes like black licorice too? Are you f***ing kidding me?
Still gross. So the engines get fixed and Billups heads to the Cerritos, leaving Rutherford behind to finish up.
But today, I might have finally earned her respect.
But then the engines explode and the Queen and Rutherford are dead, forcing Billups to assume the throne. Ah, there's Tendi, and she just finds out that Rutherford is dead. Boimler and Mariner get into a fight about whether or not to allow Agamus access to a computer to help them get rescued. And then Boimler shoots Mariner. Yeah, that happened. Boimler and Agamus board the ship and get to work. It's finally time for Tendi to do something, and realizes Rutherford's implant is detected on the Monoveen.
You sure this thing can still fly? Seems pretty beat up.
Yes, yes! I can bring it online! I just need access!
Okay, I'll sub you in as the navigation controls.
There is a lot of back and forth in this episode. Turns out no one is dead. They're having a celebration feast because Billups got tricked into being king.
Agamus reigns! With this ship's materials, I will produce a whole fleet of murder drones! You fool! You trusted me!
Nah, I used you.
What?
Boimler tricked Agamus and used his battery to power the distress beacon.
I've been using your power cell to send a distress signal. You were too busy scheming to notice. You've been boimed.
And never gave him access to anything but the lights. Good job, Boimler.
You dare mock Agamus? I shall blind you!
Billups finds out the truth and tells his mom he is staying with Starfleet.
I want to be a Starfleet officer like you. Just drop me off at the Academy. I can be the next 7 of 9. Agamus of 1.
7 of 9 from Voyager. And Picard. Agamus ends up in evil computer jail. I thought there might be like a nomad in here or something. That one has a Klingon insignia, and that's the CPS logo. I don't recognize anything else. If I had a pick on this episode, and I mentioned it earlier, it's the amount of back and forth. That's just an editing thing, but I feel like they could have stayed in one place for longer than a few seconds. There are two plot points that I deliberately left out. The first one was just for pacing, and that was Boimler was supposed to be on this dangerous mission, and Mariner had him reassigned to do Agamus duty with her, because she thought he just wasn't ready, and he proves her wrong. The other was this thing about Billups and royal copulation. This is just my opinion, but it wasn't necessary. Kind of like the mating Mugato scene I left out in that video. It's great having Jeffrey Combs back in Star Trek. I'm a big fan of his. I'm also a horror movie guy, and he was in 1999's House on Haunted Hill, Fear.com, the Reanimator movies, and just a whole ton of other stuff in that genre. Just gonna throw this in at the end here because my friend Dusty from Arkansas is visiting. She got to see this before everybody else. Pointed out, and I sort of noticed this but didn't think to put it in the video, about how Agamus is very much like Hal. From 2001, yeah, from 2001, A Space Odyssey. Very good. Thanks, Dusty.
You're welcome.
This is a closer look at Star Trek Lower Decks Season 2, Episode 8, I Excretus. This is the pre-title sequence, and the Cerritos goes to warp while the Lower Decks crew are out in their EV suits. I only bring this up because, could you imagine? That would really suck.
Engage.
They're continuing with the referential episode titles. I Excretus is like I Borg from TNG, or iRobot, where that came from. The Latin means one who separates, but I'm betting the writers are using the more modern English connotation, which would be one who, you know, poops. So the whole thing with this episode is that Starfleet has sent someone to the Cerritos to evaluate the crew, and Captain Freeman, of course, wants a good score. The drill administrator is Shari Yin-Yam, who is Pandronian, a species we haven't seen since the animated series. For good reason, their character design is biologically is kind of ridiculous. They seem very proud of this. It's even in the official Easter eggs on the Blu-ray. But what they haven't mentioned is that, like many other characters on TAS, the original Ari Bim-Bam was voiced by James Doohan. You know, Scotty. The deal with Shari Yin-Yam is she acts like one of those motivational speakers that I just want to punch in the head. There's a lot going on here. There are these, like, mini holodeck booths that have simulations based on real Starfleet situations that give you a score based on how you do, or what you do. The Lower Decks crew are given command scenarios, and the senior staff go off to perform the normal Lower Decks duties. So they switch. Mariner goes first and is given a Mirror Universe program. We've seen the Mirror Universe in pretty much every Trek except TNG. Oh, they're doing the TOS Mirror Universe. That's the outfit Uhura had on in Mirror Mirror. Rutherford has a mustache and goatee like Mirror Spock, and so does Shax, and Boimler.
Long live the Empire!
Long live the...
Wait, did you just salute me with your left hand?
Our Mariner is right-handed!
No, I just dubbed. I strained this shoulder.
The left-hand thing is from Ship in a Bottle, when Data was Sherlock Holmes and the fake Geordi caught the thing with his left hand. And the shoulder thing could be a nod to Miles O'Brien always hurting his shoulder kayaking.
Flogging a Vulcan!
Get her!
That noise is from Invasion of the Body Snatchers. So yeah, Mariner fails her first test. Tendi gets to be chief medical officer and has to deal with a paralyzed Klingon. This is directly from the TNG episode Ethics, when Worf was paralyzed and asked Riker to perform the Hechbot. See, disabled Klingons are supposed to do a ritual suicide. Well, watch.
You must help me kill myself. I broke my back picking up a peanut.
Let's send you off to Stovakor.
Stovakor is the Klingon version of heaven.
No! You must use my ceremonial blade!
Ew.
That's a diktok.
Points deducted.
You refuse to honor my culture? Ooh. Just give me the knife!
Get me 300 cc's of any type of poison!
I have to die!
They have giant hearts! So many backup organs!
Klingons have backup organs, and that's called brachol. And Tandy fails her first test, too. Mariner's second test is straight out of the TOS episode Spectre of the Gun, when Kirk and company were at the OK Corral. And that's what the set looked like, too.
Oh. Calm down. Horses love me. I'm a maverick.
Maverick? Maybe. Yeah, that would most likely kill her, but she fails this test, too. Rutherford's first test is from The Wrath of Khan, except in that movie, Spock ended up doing this, not Scotty, but he was dressed like that.
I have to, son. I'm chief engineer.
That sounds so good.
Ow! Hot! Maybe if I... Freaking radiation! Got it!
And Rutherford fails, too. And now we have Boimler, who goes through the Borg simulation. This is great.
All right, can't adjust the frequency anymore. Yoink!
Boimler kicks ass at this.
Oh, an escape sphere.
Woohoo!
The Borg baby thing we only saw once in TNG because it makes no sense. The Borg expand by assimilating existing species, not reproduction. All those different species wouldn't be able to mate anyway, so they got rid of the whole Borg baby thing, even though it's very disturbing. The escape sphere is from First Contact. Boimler finishes with a 79%, but that's not good enough for him, so he goes back in.
Do it again. Hit me!
He says, hit me! Like Heath Ledger did in Dark Knight. Mariner's third test is called Naked Time, which is from the name of the TOS episode, The Naked Time, which didn't literally mean a time to be naked, or that's what they do with it here. I'm going to skip over this because it's kind of disturbing. The Lower Decks crew are in Freeman's ready room, chowing down on some first-class grub and lamenting their failures when they realize Boimler is still taking his test.
It hurts me to say this, but maybe the bridge crew's jobs are actually harder than we thought.
Yeah, well, I'm sure right now they're finding out just how hard it is to do our jobs, too.
The senior staff get a test about Klingons.
Really? There are Klingons on the other side of the hull, and this is our job?
If they wanted us to stack these, then why are they shaped like this?
The stacking thing is a good point. Hexagonal cargo containers make no sense.
Quick, you seen a Q come through here?
Q is on the ship?
Forget I said anything.
Plus, what?
Get to battle station!
The Q reference is from the TNG episode Cupid, when Q put everybody in a Robin Hood setting, and the Jem'Hadar are from DS9.
I got it!
If you're going to stack hexagonal containers, it should be like this. You know how bees do it? And they fail their test, too.
Now that both sides have been put through individual tests, your last drill will be a joint exercise.
Steal the Cerritos from Space Dock and use it to save Spock on the Genesis planet. Okay?
Yep, that's from Search for Spock.
Congratulations, Ensign. You've earned yourself a trip to the brig.
I've never been sent to the brig.
Now you have.
On what ground? I am speaking.
They can't even get along long enough to get a space dock. Freeman figures out that the drills were meant to show what it's like to be on the other side, like, no kidding, and goes to thank the drill administrator.
Yo, Sherry Yingo Yango, we figured you out, girl.
Sherry Yingo Yango. It's Sherry Yin Yum.
Oh, come on. Your drill scores are well below failing. Once they're submitted, Starfleet Command will relegate and reassign this entire crew.
So this wasn't about teamwork?
Teamwork? No, this was about saving my job.
It's up to Boimler to score high enough to save the crew's overall numbers.
If the drills aren't finished,
our scores aren't final.
Boimler, can you hear me?
Hey, Mariner, I was just about to close up this drill. I finally got
Don't
a perfect...
finish that drill, Ensign. That's an order.
Boimler's been doing the Borg thing so long, he's made it to the Borg Queen.
How's the empathy?
We were able to assimilate it.
Yep, that's the original Queen, Alice Krieger. This is taken from the scene in First Contact with Data and the Borg Queen. Freeman decides to put the Cerritos in a real dangerous situation to freak out Sherry and Yim.
Ooh, a loner crystalline entity. A crystalline entity consuming a rogue planet. Lots of crystalline entities today. Must be crystalline entity season or something.
The crystalline entity appeared twice in TNG.
Mariner, find me something else dangerous to scan. I'm in the mood for a black hole.
Why?
We're going to keep doing this until you change our score.
Oh, that's from this show's title sequence. And this is from the terribly long scene in the, well, one of them, in the motion picture.
All right, five, you win! You win! There, it's done. You pass.
Oh yeah, Boimler is still doing the Borg thing, and now he is like when Picard was Locutus of Borg. Boimler saved the day. If I had a pick on this episode, well, there wasn't too much. In typical fashion, Boimler, Tendi, and Rutherford got one test each, and Mariner got three. Compared to the last few episodes, this had more references, mostly because of the holodeck situations. The Borg stuff was a lot of fun. It was great to have the OG Borg Queen back. Not that Susanna Thompson did a bad job in Voyager. This is a closer look at Star Trek Lower Decks, Season 2, Episode 9, Hwe Do. First of all, obviously, the title is in Klingon, which is cool. You may have noticed I'm a bit of a Klingon language enthusiast ever since I got the Klingon dictionary when I was a kid. Weidu, since they never say those words in this episode, I'm basing my pronunciation on the TNG episode, The Chase, where Data and Nudok do the Bakul challenge. Nudok says, Wa cha we. 1, 2, 3.
Wa cha we.
So, Weidu translates to three ships. Oh, and those Klingon glyphs are correct. I looked them up. There's no opening sequence, so let's get right into it.
Engage.
The Cerritos is on its way to the Kantaran system to conduct a planetary survey. The trip is going to take a while, so Freeman has approved R&R for the crew until they get there.
I can't believe we all have a day off. What should we do? Stratagema tournament?
Stratagema was first seen in the TNG episode Peak Performance. I haven't pointed this out in a while, but they're all eating Mexican-inspired food, like normal. Rutherford and Mariner are, at least. Tendi has some kind of soup, and it looks like Boimler has white rice. Rutherford often has a purple frosted cupcake. And here we go with the premise of this episode, which is fun. While Boimler tries to buddy up with the command crew, we get to see what the lower decks is like on various ships. Starting with a Klingon bird of prey, Chata. Dude's filing his teeth. Ferengi do that too.
And, stationed at the captain's side, I will be the logical choice to be the new first officer.
Logical? Are you a Vulcan now?
Could you imagine serving with those Bignoks?
Bignok is Klingon for coward. Yes, now the Vulcan cruiser Cheval.
I have detected an anomalous surge of Metreon particles in system 7743.8.
I can't remember if Metreon particles appeared anywhere else, but that was a thing in Insurrection.
Remove this! I don't want that stench on my bridge.
So to impress Captain Dorg, oh yeah, that smaller dude's name is Ma, he gets rid of the body for him.
Right, Carno in the forest with Myra?
It is hard to lose weight when you can replicate any food you want.
In search for a bridge buddy, Boimler strikes out with Kayshan. That's an interesting pottery shape Shax has going there. Boimler mentions Bajor, which sets Shax off, so there's no bridge buddy here either.
Resisting fighting fascism is a full-time job!
He's not kidding!
He's talking about the Cardassian occupation of Bajor, which was going on until just before Sisko took command of DS9.
Yes, good boy! That is what we will do to enemy Patak.
That's a Targ, and Patak, which used to be spelled like this, back in TNG, they changed it for some reason, is a common Klingon insult, like to be weird.
Captain, your Targ is most impressive, like Kor's Hound at the Battle of Klaktik el Bracht.
Okay, Kor is this guy, who was the first Klingon commander ever seen in the TOS episode Errand of Mercy. He was also in the animated series and as a Dahar master in Deep Space Nine. Klaktik el Bracht is a famous battle between the Klingons and Romulans in 2271, mentioned in both DS9 and Enterprise.
Why would you modify already adequate long-range sensors when that is outside of your duties?
I had a gut feeling that increasing our sensor range may prove illuminating.
Man, Vulcan ships are dry. I mean, of course they are, but jeez. El Capitan in Yosemite National Park from Star Trek V, but in that case, it was Kirk doing the free climbing, Spock in the rocket boots, and McCoy was on the ground like a reasonable person. This is why rocket boots are so dangerous. Boimler tries Captain Freeman, but she and Mariner are arguing about lady issues, so he gets the heck out of there.
Mr. Boimler, are you also from Hawaii?
He has to be. Only people who grew up on the islands like us could describe it like that.
You're all from Hawaii.
Aloha. Yep, small galaxy, huh?
What are the chances that there would be three native Hawaiians on a starship with a crew of only 200?
Perhaps you could look to me as your confidant. In Klingon culture, they designate those who stand with one another as Chadich.
That's the third reference to Chadich in this series.
Just tell them you're not from Hawaii.
I tried, sort of.
Rutherford has his DS9 model from An Embarrassment of Duplers, the one I used to have.
We've lost our way.
The Empire still strikes terror. Klingon blood runs as reddish pink as ever.
Reddish pink blood? The most we see Klingon blood is in the Undiscovered Country, and it looked like Pepto-Bismol. This has not been consistent throughout the series.
It is troubling to see a proud cast of warriors lose their Lordesh.
Lordesh means tradition.
Oh, hi! Are you ready to give us present?
With the weapons and information I've armed them with, they've thrown the entire quadrant into discord.
So far on Lower Decks, the Pakleds have been the primary antagonists, which is kind of weird, except now we know at least a faction of the Klingon Empire has been providing them with weapons and intel.
Cry havoc and let slip the dogs of war!
That's a direct Shakespearean quote from General Chang in Undiscovered Country.
Cry havoc and let slip the dogs of war!
I think it was the chef in the biolab with the sniper rifle that can shoot through walls.
The sniper rifle that can shoot through walls came from that Ezri Dax episode of DS9.
We need another boomer.
What? No! One Viruvian bomb is enough!
The Pakleds were mining Viruvian ore in the episode Kayshan, His Eyes Open.
We already used it.
You used it? On what? Why?
We wanted to test it on a big asteroid, but then it stopped working.
It was a bomb! You can only use it once!
You can only use a bomb once. So the Cerritos gets into it with the Pakleds and that bird of prey. Oh yeah, the Ritos shirts are a reference to the disco shirts in Discovery. Since the crew was on R&R, there's Anbo Jitsu. That's from the TNG episode Cupid, when Picard was Robin Hood. And someone doing Data's Sherlock Holmes holoprogram, unless that's like the Hugh Hefner program.
I'm not from Hawaii.
Not from Hawaii either.
Neither am I.
Oh, I'm not from Hawaii.
Wait, what now?
I'm actually from the moon.
Wait, bro. Earth's moon? That's where I'm from!
I'm from the third moon of Benzar. We're all moon buddies?
You know, some people say Modesto is like the moon of San Francisco, so I guess I'm from a moon too.
Boimler admits he's not from Hawaii, and it turns out that the other three actually are not either. But they are all from moons. Boimler's from the moon of San Francisco.
Do not talk to me of honor! I've been crushing Pakta's beneath my boots since before you were born!
I've never heard it pronounced Pakta before. It's supposed to be Patak. Hey, hey, it's the Cheval. Awesome. The Vulcans are always doing cool stuff like this in Enterprise. So Ma'a kills the naughty Klingon captain and calls off the attack on the Federation ship since he's the captain now, because that's how things work on Klingon ships. The combined forces of the Cerritos and the Cheval drive the Pakleds away.
They're all from moons. Look at them. Probably talking about tides and werewolves. I was so close.
Tides and werewolves, that's freaking great. This is also great. They do the lower decks on a Borg cube, which, depending on how you look at it, they're all lower decks. And this is the first time they do a thing behind the end credits. If I had a pick on this episode, it would mostly be on me. Seriously. I like the looking at the lower decks on various ships angle, but I found it harder to write this episode. That may be because I did this while my 5-year-old nephew was visiting, and he makes me tired. The title of this episode is Three Ships, and I assume they are referring to the Cerritos, the Chita, and the Cheval. But we also looked at the lower decks of the Pakled Clump Ship and the Borg Cube 90182, which is a zip code in, you guessed it, Los Angeles. I think it's interesting that they are portraying Vulcan ships like they were in Enterprise. This show's timeline is post-TNG, and from what I gather from that show, all Federation ships are Federation ships. The Vulcans didn't have their own at that point because they're part of the Federation. There was lots of Klingon in this one, which I find fun. I did my best with pronunciation, and I'm pretty close. I also paid attention to my English translations as far as syntax and punctuation is concerned. Certain Klingon letters are meant to be capitalized and some are not. The people who wrote the closed captioning were certainly not aware of this. This is a closer look at Star Trek Lower Decks Season 2, Episode 10, First Contact. Wow, we're at the finale of the second season already, and that's the Archimedes and Obana-class starship, which is basically a gussied-up Excelsior class. I should probably go back and look to see how many new classes of starships Lower Decks has added to canon. The shipyards at Utopia Planitia must be hopping. The real reason for all the ships, of course, is that animating new designs is a heck of a lot cheaper than building physical models or rendering 3D ones.
Friend Captain Sonia Gomez, so that we can assist in her first contact of the Lepirians.
Captain Sonia Gomez used to be Ensign Gomez for 2 episodes of TNG, voiced by the same actress, Lysia Naff. I'm probably pronouncing her name wrong. She is probably most famous as the well-endowed Martian from Total Recall, the real one, not the stupid one where they had that elevator that goes through the Earth's core. The Lepirians from the planet Lepiria are spelled like this, but they're in the LAP system, spelled like this. I don't know why. So the deal here is that Captain Freeman is supposed to be getting promoted to a more prominent ship, but she won't be able to bring along her senior staff nor her daughter. And this is all before the opening sequence.
Engage.
And we're really piling it on. That's a Captain Picard Day type banner. Cetacean Ops is mentioned again, and Rutherford is having a problem with his ocular implant. Mariner tells Ransom, Shax, and Billups about Captain Freeman leaving the Cerritos. The Cerritos and the Not Excelsior head out to do their first contact stuff. Oh wait, see, this is what I was talking about in my video for an embarrassment of Duplers. That one must have been a baby starbase because this one is, look how huge this one is.
Guests.
I'm okay. Please don't. It's fine.
Don't worry about it. I've done way worse in front of much more intimidating captains.
Okay, first of all, I'm sorry, really, but her voiceover work is just terrible. I don't know if it's the mics or the direction she's given, but ugh. Second, that's from the TNG episode Q Who, when the Ensign Gomez spilt her hot chocolate all over Captain Picard.
This is where we watch the Trivoli Pulsar.
The Trivoli Pulsar thing is from season 1. Captain Freeman finds out that her senior staff knows about her promotion, and this causes all kinds of arguments, which is exactly what Mariner wanted.
Report! The Lepirian sun just emitted an unpredicted flare. It's headed straight for that planetoid!
Then the Lepirian sun suddenly emits a solar flare, which hits a planetoid, which then explodes somehow. which then severely damages the Not Excelsior. I'm not Neil deGrasse Tyson or anything, but I don't think that's how that works.
Unless we figure something out, first contact is going to be us crashing into that planet.
That planetoid was stuffed with radiolytic isotopes.
There we go. Some blah blah about how the planetoid exploded. I'm surprised they didn't say it was comprised of explodanium or something.
If we can get a tractor beam on them...
Not gonna happen, Captain. That debris is caught in the orbit, too.
What about the deflector? I mean, isn't that its whole job? To deflect?
If we project any sort of energy field, it'll draw the plasma right to us.
Can't we just warp past the debris?
That's not the
So they go through this whole thing about why the Cerritos can't just use a tractor beam or the navigational deflector to save the Not Excelsior. And they yell at Kayshan for suggesting warp. It is generally a bad idea to go to warp inside a star system, but they literally do it all the time. Mariner and Freeman go to the captain's yacht so they can use it to navigate through the debris. I assume this is because it is more maneuverable than a full-size starship, but then why not just use a shuttle, which is even smaller and they have tons of those?
I think I know how to save the Archimedes.
Well, the hull itself has magnetic shielding. There's no way to discharge it.
Yes, so we remove the hull.
Rutherford has a plan to save Not Excelsior, which is to remove the hull plating from the Cerritos so it doesn't attract the ionic plasma debris. This is so stupid. So now the entire crew gets to work removing the exterior hull plating. That's how the maglocks work to detach the main deflector in first contact. Okay, hold on again. Archer and Reed had to remove just one hull plate from the NX-01 Enterprise in that Romulan episode, and that was a huge deal. This is the entire larger ship, and they only have a few hours. I was wondering why the bridge crew are in EV suits. The view screen doesn't work for some reason, and they literally took the front of the bridge off so they can see. Oh my god. Oh yeah, the reason for Rutherford's glitch is because he's been saving his memories of Tendi in triplicate for, in case he gets amnesia again. But the reason he lost his memories in the first place is because Shax tore out his implant, so if that happened again, it wouldn't matter how many copies. This is so stupid. Rutherford has no choice but to purge his redundant files, which brings up a file from protected memory about how he got his implant in the first place. This is to be a mysterious plot line later.
Access controls are fused. We're gonna have to release this one manually. We still have one more hull plate, and it's a big one.
Oh look, we see Cetacean Ops for the first time. I mentioned in a previous video that the Enterprise D also had Cetacean Ops, which I think is silly, but whatever. Someone has to swim to the bottom of the aquarium to release the mag clamps for the last piece of hull plating. Why? So Boimler is the one who has to swim to a ridiculous location to release the mag clamps. They did something like this in Stargate Atlantis, but at least when MacGyver did it, the reason was the city was flooded. Who would put anything at the bottom of an aquarium that humans have to use? Boimler gets the plate detached, but he comes out of the tank in cardiac arrest.
Boimler! Talk to me!
Did I miss Captain Freeman Day?
Yes, he's gonna be okay!
I saw a koala!
The koala thing is from when Tendi's friend ascended in season 1. He saw Abraham Lincoln and a koala before turning into pure energy.
Everyone, if you move to the back of the ship, there's a chance you'll survive.
You're crashing into a planet, and you're not the Enterprise D saucer section, so I don't think so. So the Cerritos saves the Not Excelsior with a tractor beam that they said they couldn't use before. So first contact goes well, and there's all kinds of starships orbiting Lyperia. It looks like some Cali-class ships, the Not Excelsior, and an old-school Oberth-class ship. That Voyager-looking thing is a Nova-class, like the Equinox from Voyager.
Like Jadzia Dax?
Who the f*** is that? I don't know who that is. No, like Spock.
Jadzia Dax and Spock. So everyone survived and everyone is happy, but then Captain Freeman gets arrested by Starfleet Security for the destruction of Pakled Planet.
The crew?
Starfleet Security, this woman is under arrest.
Are you freaking kidding me? If I had a pick on this episode, and I'm going to, if you can't tell, I wasn't a big fan of this one, and that kind of makes me mad because the whole reason I got into doing these videos is to promote something that I love, Star Trek, and to sort of show the modern critics that new Trek isn't so bad. One of the main criticisms of modern Trek is that a lot of the writers treat their storylines like teen dramas. And this is exactly what's going on here. I left a lot of that crap out of this video, but Tendi was sad because she thought Dr. Tana was going to transfer her, and then it turns out she gets promoted, and Rutherford was hanging on his memories of Tendi, but realized if he can't make new ones, then what's the point? Mariner and Freeman did interpersonal conflict mother-daughter stuff the whole episode, and that's on top of the things I already covered in this video. There was some action, sure, but nothing made any sense. And that's what happens when you write your Star Trek episode like something from the CW. If you remember the finale of Season 1, there were cool ship battles, Riker and the Titans save the day, which was awesome, it was great. Now we have Drama Club and Freeman gets arrested with a bullcrap to be continued. Maybe I'm just in a bad mood. I haven't watched Season 3 since last year, but I don't remember being terribly mad about it. Well, there is a weird peanut hamper episode. But hopefully, as I get into my Season 3 videos, some of this crap turns around. That was Lower Decks Season 2, Episode 10, First Contact. I'm Eric Kelly from KellyPlanet.com. See you for Season 3. Live long and prosper. Hi, it's me again, and if you liked that video, please hit the button so that I know. And if you didn't, well, that's okay too. Sometimes I miss stuff or I'm completely incorrect, and if that's the case, please let me know in the comments so I can fix my brain. Here are some other videos that I've done, and there's more Trek and other content from me on my website, KellyPlanet.com. See you next time.